Welcome, Jacob.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
Good. How do I pronounce your name? Jacob or Jacob?
Jacob, it's okay.
How do you pronounce your name? I'm curious.
Well, here in Poland, everybody calls me Kuba, but this is some kind of contraction from Jacob. But Jacob is as fine as well.
Okay. Welcome.
Welcome.
I haven't met you yet, though. So tell me about yourself. I'm assuming you're Polish.
Well, I joined Kolingo yesterday. This
Oh.
is actually my third or fourth class.
Okay, great.
Hello. Hi.
And how did you hear about Kolingo?
Well, I was searching for some conversation tools in internet, and I encountered this page. Hello?
Yep, can you hear me?
So, what else? I am 28 years old, and I work as a programmer, and I would like to move to Germany in 1 year, and in order to, I would like to improve my conversation skills in English, so because I
Okay.
have no opportunity to use it right now in my present job.
Yeah, I understand. Well, this is a really good place to work on your speaking skills and listening skills and conversation,
Yeah.
everything. So, well, we're glad you're here.
Can I
And
have one question?
yes, of course.
Is how often these topics change? Is it repeatable or
They're always
you
changing.
know, it
Always.
always, yeah.
Every hour it's different. So I will never teach this class again. I have never
Oh,
taught it before. I will never teach it again.
super.
This is the only one. Traditional Polish music and dance, one time. But we will record this class. So I mean, I've taught over 500 classes, maybe 600 classes, and each one is completely different.
Super.
So they're all different. So you never have to repeat a class. Now, the grammar or the English part, the pronunciation lessons or the grammar lessons or something like that, we might review more and more and more over and over and over to
Yeah.
get to review that. But the topics always are changing. And every teacher has different topics that they tend to enjoy teaching. And so if you go to my classes, you'll probably find classes about things like food or travel or culture, like this class, or music. Teach a lot of music classes, stuff like that.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. And what part of Poland are you from?
Well, I grew up in Szczecin, which is northwestern part of Poland, but I come to my stud I studied computer science in Warsaw, which is the capital of Poland. And I currently live here.
And you live in Warsaw, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So it sounds like you have very good English. Sounds like your English is very good.
Oh, thank you.
Now I've only had a couple other students from Poland here at Kolingo, but I have them often. Have you met any of the other Polish students here in Poland?
Well, I have met Wiesław
Wiesław,
two
yeah.
classes. Yes, but he's the only one
Okay.
from Poland I met.
Okay. I often have another guy that comes here a lot from Silesia. Name is Krzysztof. So he comes to a lot of my classes.
Okay.
He was in my last class, actually, part of it. But so, good people. So welcome. We're glad to have you here. And have you met Heidi before? Heidi just joined us.
Hello, Heidi.
Hello.
Why don't you introduce yourself to Jacob, Heidi?
I'm Heidi from Japan. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. I'm Kuba from Poland, Jakub from Poland.
Jakub. All right, good. Now that we all know each other, we can continue. So I like to just teach. I often teach classes that I want to learn about. So, for instance, I don't know very much about Polish music and Polish folk dancing and stuff like that. So I thought, why not teach a class on that? And also, I tend to have I have a couple of recurring students from Poland, so that's another reason. So I tend to teach classes because I know who my students are. Or sometimes my students will give me ideas for a class. Like maybe Heidi will say something that's interesting to me. Like Heidi posted an interesting article on Facebook, so I taught a class about it. Or, Krzysztof, my other Polish friend, talked about Bigos, and I had a class on Bigos last
Right.
week. So just anything. It could be about anything. And so I often get my ideas from you guys. So watch what you say. I might teach a class on it in the future. And as far as our English goes, we're going to talk about third conditional tense. That'll be our grammar skill. Does anyone know what third conditional?
Hypothetical past regret.
Hypothetical. It's in the past. So for instance, I could ask you a question which might elicit a third conditional answer. Is there any special artistic skill which you wish you had learned as a child?
I draw a lot of pictures. Sometimes my picture went to a competition and I got some gold medal. So if I had been continuing practice the drawing, I would be very good.
Ah, okay. So Heidi used to be a good drawer. She used to draw great pictures when she was younger. And maybe if she had continued her drawing, maybe she'd be a great artist now. So that's the idea. That's the third condition. If I had continued, I continued with drawing. If I had blah blah blah, then blah blah blah. The thing about conditional is it's almost always an if-then construction. If something blah blah, then something blah blah. If then is usually conditional tense. So like if you're a programmer, you might know about that. Hello, Claudio.
Oh, hi, Anthony. How are you today?
Good. How about yourself?
Oh, I'm good too. I have been maybe 7 days without study English. Then so my English today is a little bit more slow in special. To understand when you was talking, I don't know if I understand all that you said, but I'm good because 7 days without study, the English maybe become a little bit more deeply because you need to take the words again, and the words not so fresh.
Definitely.
So if I don't understand you sometimes, I apologize now.
Oh, don't worry about it. There's no need to apologize. But if you ever have a question, just ask.
Okay, thank you.
I was asking if there's any special artistic skill that you wish you had learned as a child. Heidi said she wished she would have drawn more as a child. She used to draw a little bit, drawings, and she wished she would have done that more as a child, and maybe now she would be a great artist or something. So, what about you guys, Jakub or Clara?
Well, for instance, if I had been more focused on my guitar lessons, I would have played in some funky group now.
Yes. Yes, you might be.
Maybe would be now. Yes, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, so you used to take guitar lessons?
Yes, for about half a year.
Yeah.
No many successes in this area, so nothing to be proud of.
Well, it takes a lot of practice. It takes a long time.
Right.
Long take practice every day. Yes. Yeah. Do you play any other instruments?
Actually, no. I don't. I bought a bass guitar and tried to learn on my own, but I don't have time for it, but I don't have this kind of appetite for or fuel for it, so mm-hmm. You know.
Yes, you have to have patience and you have to have a passion.
Both. Right.
Yes, and if you don't have either, then it's going to be really difficult to learn an instrument. Learning a language is hard enough. It's similar, learning an instrument, learning a language. They're both, it takes a lot of determination to get really good
right.
at it. So, yeah. What about you, Claudio?
Oh, I've tried to learn guitar all my life, but I can't learn. In fact, in my opinion, guitar is easier instrument that you learn bad, but you play bad. Anyone, I know a lot of people that said that they know to play guitar, but in fact, a few people really can play guitar with quality, soul.
Yeah.
Yes, but if I had studied a little bit more guitar when I was children, maybe I would know it in these days. Mm-hmm. But for me, it's very difficult to. I have no coordination. I don't know if I say correct the words or the phrase, if you understand me, but
I understand you perfectly. We'll talk more about the grammar and the construction later on in class, but I can understand exactly what you're saying, so you're fine. But later on we'll talk about how to perfectly construct the third conditional sentence. So don't worry.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
The important thing is I understand you.
I forgot about third conditional. It's very difficult to remember third conditional when I am talking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's okay. I want to talk a little bit about consonants, especially linking final consonants to the beginning of other words. So, like consonant cluster, we call this in English. So, for instance, when we're doing the third conditional, I might say something like, if I had been born in Poland, I would know Polish now, language, you know. Had been, yeah, let me pull up my screen here. Had had been includes one of these difficult consonant clusters. And some people might add something between this D and B, because it's hard to say D, B together with nothing in between. Some people it's easier than others. For instance, Jakub might not have a problem with it because his language has lots and lots of consonant clusters. Whereas Heidi might have it might be harder for Heidi because her language doesn't really have any consonant clusters. So it just depends on what your native tongue is and, you know, and learning how it feels to speak English properly. So another one. Also, so would speak also has this same, another difficult speak
Polish. Speak.
Speak would, so it's a z, would speak.
Would speak.
Yeah.
Would speak.
And
have been, and how is the correct way to say had been, Anthony? Had been is correct.
So if you're talking about the vowel sound, it's not E, it's I. Had been.
And been.
Yeah, like been or been is better. Been. A common mistake. Been. Now, maybe in England they might say been, but in the United States we say
been.
Kind of like the name had been.
I could say I'd been.
Yes, if I'd been born in Poland.
If I'd been born. If I'd been you is correct. Oh, if I were you.
Well, it depends on what you're saying. If I were you is much more common.
It's much more common. If I was you, some native speakers usually said.
Yeah, if I were you. If I were you, I'd stay right there. That sounds like a threat.
If I had been born in Poland, I would speak Polish perfectly.
Okay. Ah, good. What about, okay, so you had the first one perfect. I didn't hear, let me hear that last part one more time.
Mm-hmm. I would speak Polish perfectly.
Good. All right, very good. So, who wants to, how about, Claudio, do you want to try that sentence?
Okay, and if I'd been born in Poland, I would speak Polish perfectly.
Okay, very good, very good. So, so let's try to think about this linking these large consonant clusters. Let's try to keep that in mind for the rest of the class, and I'll try to look at some things that we can. Keep that in mind. Okay, so I'll be listening. In the meantime, let's talk about third conditional a little bit more. So I have some more to talk about here. All right. So, Jakub, would you begin, please?
Okay. First, you can use the third conditional to express regret about something that happened in the past. It is also used to hypothetically explore other possible scenarios of past situations. If I had known it was your birthday, I would have greeted you. If they had studied more, they would have passed the test.
Sorry about that. Yep.
If you had asked me about the plan, I would have told you about it. And if she hadn't lost her job, she wouldn't have stolen the money.
Okay. Continue. Very good.
So, it is impossible to go back and change the past. However, the third conditional is a way to communicate a different outcome if the original condition had been different.
Okay, and then we have, I won't make you read all this because it's ridiculous. There's just so much. It's like equations in algebra.
Right.
But this is the construction. If you had past participle, like taken, you know, you know, looked, you know, closely, you know, more closely, you would have saw it, you know. Mm-hmm. And the negative construction is the same, except for you had, if you had not, of course, and would not have, had not, all that. So it's just negating it. Yeah. Okay, Heidi, will you second, please?
Second. You can switch the first and the second clause of a third conditional sentence. In this case, you don't need a comma between the clause.
Mm-hmm.
Construction subject plus would have plus past participle if plus subject plus had plus past participle. I would have greeted you if I had known it was your birthday. They would have passed the test if they had studied more. I would have told you about. I would have told you about it if you had asked me about the plan.
Okay, good, and good consonant clusters. I would have told. Yes, very good. So this is just basically you can put the if in the middle here. It's, instead of if I had known it was your birthday, you can end the sentence in that way. You can switch it around and it still means the same thing, right? Claudio, continue.
Okay. Third, you can create third conditional sentence by making questions about the past using what if you or the subject had plus past participle, and answering then using the third conditional. What if you had been born 100 years ago? What if we could have witnessed it? I don't know.
Witnessed.
Mm-hmm. What if we could have witnessed the Renaissance? What if Microsoft had not created Windows?
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. So now we know how to how to form a third conditional question. Speaking of questions, do you have any questions for me
about? Yes, Anthony. I have a question. I'm not sure if I understood the third example, the example that I read.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a kind of questions, but this construction is very strange to me. I don't understand the sense of that phrase.
Okay, what exactly about that last question that you...
Oh, can you show... Again, I don't remember. Okay. Oh, yes. What if you had been born 100 years ago? I don't understand what the phrase means.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it's kind of an open question. It's like, it's kind of implies, like, what would be different... what would you, what would your life be like? So it's kind of like, it's impossible. It's not, of course it's not possible to be born. You can't change when you were born, but you can ask a question like, I wonder what it would be like, how life would be different if I had been born 100. So you're not asking a very specific, there's no right answer to that question. It's kind of a rhetorical question. It's like, I wonder. So, you can say, Well, I probably would have a different outlook on life. I'd probably have a different personality, maybe. Maybe I'd live a shorter lifespan because, I don't know. There's a lot of different things you can guess about what might be different. So it's kind of like a, I wonder kind of question.
It's a kind of, for example, what would be? For example, what would be if you had been born 100 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
It makes sense. it's what the would... same question, for example, what would be of you if you had been born 100 years ago? It's correct?
Kind of. You can't really say what would be of you. You'd probably say what would be different, or what would you be doing if you had been... So you can say things like that, and you can answer it however you want.
What if you had been born? Is this the same means of what would do if you? I don't know if. Okay.
Yeah, it implies all those things. It's kind of, it leaves it open so that you can answer how you want. So it's kind of just like a very common question in the United States, saying like, what if? And it's just like, what if something is different? You know, what if something had been different? You know, what would be different then? You know.
I understand.
It's a common construction.
In this phrase, what get the same means? For example, and if you had been born.
Excuse me.
If I change what, the word what, to end, for example, is the same phrase.
How do you, so say it for me, speak, ask the question to me.
For example, and I will type, okay.
Yeah.
Is the same.
Oh, okay. And if you'd been so, well, that could, you can say that only if you are asking a series of questions. So if you're asking a series of rhetorical third conditional questions, then you can continue by saying "and," but only if you're continuing from a previous thought. You could say, "What if you had been born 100 years ago?" I don't know. And if you had been born to a king. And what if you, you know, and, you know, but you can't really start off by saying and. You can't start a question like that. You have to say what if.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I understand. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yep, no problem. Okay, any other questions?
Understood.
Okay, no more questions about that? We can talk about it a little bit in the future. In the meantime, let's talk about... Let's talk about Poland's music. And I see a mistake here. I see a mistake here. If anyone knows anything about geography, I'm sure Jakub sees it. they have the wrong country in this.
Right.
Yeah, that's not Poland. That is Bulgaria or something like, or Romania? I can't even tell.
It's Romania, right?
It's certainly not Poland. Poland is here. So, yeah. Anyway, but enough about that. oh, yes, the Polish is a lot too. So, we'll learn about the history, the music, the dance, just the different folk traditions of Poland. And if this is hard to read, I will also... post the thing here. Okay. So, Poland, officially the Republic of Poland, is a country in Central Europe bordered by Germany to the west, the Czech Republic, and Slovakia to the south, Ukraine, Belarus, and Lithuania to the east, and the Baltic Sea to the north. The culture of Poland is closely connected with its intricate 1,000-year history. Its unique character developed as a result of its geography at the convergence of various European regions. The people of Poland have traditionally been seen as hospitable to artists from abroad and eager to follow cultural and artistic trends popular in other countries. In the 19th and 20th centuries, the Polish focus on cultural advancement often took precedence over political and economic activity. These factors have contributed to the versatile nature of Polish art, with all its intricate details. Today, Poland is a highly developed country. However, its rich heritage and tradition remains. So let's talk about the performing arts. We'll look at the video.
What does it mean, intricate?
Intricate details. Yes, what does intricate mean? Anybody have an idea? Intricate?
I have an idea. Yes. Sorry.
Complicated.
Yeah, kind of complicated. Little tiny details.
Maybe a kind of in Portuguese we have the very, very similar word. That means it's the kind of, for instance, is a policy story. It's a kind of moves. The story is very intricate, with many details, with many happens, a lot of things happen. You, in my opinion, is the
complex. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay.
That's complex. Complex.
The origin of Polish music can be traced as far back as the 13th century, from which manuscripts have been found in Stary Sas containing polyphonic compositions related to the Parisian Notre Dame school. Polish folk music was collected in the 19th century by Oskar Kolberg as a part of a wave of Polish national revival. With the coming of the World Wars and the communist state, folk traditions were oppressed or subsumed into state-approved folk ensembles. The most famous of the state ensembles were the Mazosia and Slosk. You'll have to help me with the pronunciation. Sorry.
Mazowsze and Śląsk.
Okay, thank you. Both of which still perform. Though these bands had a regional touch to their output, the overall sound was a homogenized mixture of Polish styles.
Śląskie Silesia.
Oh, Śląsk.
This is Polish.
Yeah. Śląsk. Okay, that's where Krzysztof is from. Our friend Krzysztof is from Silesia. Homogenized, what does that mean?
Whoa.
When the the opposite of heterogeneous, and when, for example, the tomatoes, the when I cook in a kind of the liquid is homogeneous. When the thing is similar in all parts.
Exactly. When it's similar in all parts. So, exactly. So basically, the overall sound is a mixture. Everything is sounds the same, with a different style.
Maybe it's a kind of equality.
It kind of equalizes everything, yes. So they're saying that the different styles have kind of mixed. The most recognizable instruments in traditional Polish music are the koza, which is a Polish bagpipe, as you can see here. The Polish pipes are more related in appearance to some old German pipes. It uses a large goatskin bag with the hair out, and a single reed chanter, cylindrical bore and deep pitch, with a large horn and brass bell at the end. The brass drone typically has the same bell. It is usually bellows blown and produces a mellow, low pitch. A carved goat's head stalk, similar to the duda, is common. The single reeds are often made of a cane blade lapped onto copper tubing. So you can see... I don't see a picture over there. The suka, which is like the gadulka, this is played vertically on the knee or hanging from a strap. Whoops. And the strings are stopped at the side with the fingernails. The body of the instrument is very similar to the modern violin, but the neck is very wide. Look how wide that neck is. And the peg box is crude. This is thought to be the missing link between the upside-down or knee chordophone instruments and the modern violin. That's interesting. Now let's talk about dance. Examples of traditional Polish dances are the mazurka, a lively three-beat form that accompanies a vibrant improvisational dance. The mazurka comes from Mazowsze. How do you say it again?
Mazowsze.
Oh, I think I said it.
Oh, right.
Region in east-central Poland. The Krakowiak. The Krakowiak is a duple-time galloping dance. It's the national dance of Poland and is generally performed in traditional Polish garb with women in flowery skirts and aprons and men in embroidered vests and square hats. What do they mean? So obviously, from context, what does garb mean?
Garb.
Look at this context. Performed in traditional Polish garb with women in flowery skirts and aprons and men in embroidered vests and square hats. So what is garb?
It's a kind of clothes, traditional clothes, yes. Traditional pants, maybe shirts, another kind.
Yep, it just means clothes, yep. Outfits, clothes.
Clothes.
Clothes. Not clothes, but clothes. You see, it's actually rhymes. When in America we rhyme clothes, and in the United States we say clothes and clothes are basically exactly the same pronunciation. Clothes. I'm wearing nice clothes today.
That's just how it is. And that's two words have the same means? Clothes
no.
And
no, no,
clothes.
No. No,
the same means no. Oh, okay, I'm wrong. Yeah. And the same way to pronounce clothes and clothes.
Yeah, basically. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. We say it pretty fast.
Clothes.
I like your clothes today. I like your clothes today. Yep. By the way, here's some interesting facts. The most popular name for a dog in Poland is Burek, meaning a brownish gray color. Poland is the ninth biggest country in Europe. That's it? I thought it was bigger than that. And it shares frontiers with seven countries. Russia, Lithuania, Belarus, Ukraine, Slovakia, Czech Republic, and Germany. And the national symbol of Poland is the white-tailed eagle. Okay, any questions or any comments? Jakub, is this correct? Does this article look okay to you? Because sometimes they're not good articles. Do you have anything to add to it?
Well, no, exactly, but everything seems okay, but it's not the field of my interest, so I'm not an expert in this area. So.
Yeah, no problem. I just wanted to, because there was one time I was reading about Russia, like Russian culture, and it was so wrong that even I knew it was wrong. Like, it was so, like, the facts were all wrong. And, like, I could even tell it was wrong. Like, they called, like, they said something about Christmas in Russia, and they celebrated on the 25th. That's not true. And they said that the Santa Claus was called a babushka, which doesn't make any sense. Like, it was, like, totally wrong. It was 100% wrong. And, like, I'm like, where do they get this stuff? but I just want to make sure I'm not teaching the wrong So there's a video there, and I want to take a look at this video so we can listen to the music and see the dance styles, traditional dance and music of Poland. If you look to your left, you will see a YouTube button over there on your, I think that's your left, and you can watch this with me. Okay, so I'm going to add a video to this playlist. I'm going to try to watch it. Okay, so I think you're all with me here. So yeah, let's take a look at this. Okay, and just let me press the buttons because there's only one video between the three of us. So I'll press play, and then we'll talk about it when we're done.
Sorry.
No problem.
Sorry.
Here we go. Okay. All right. So sorry, that wasn't a video; it was just music. I thought we'd see some dance, but I forgot that was just a slideshow. But you get the idea. So is that like a famous song? Have you heard that a million times, or is that? I mean, I don't know.
That was the first time I heard it.
Yeah. Yeah.
W moim ogródeczku means in my garden.
Uh huh. So
maybe not a very descriptive title.
I noticed also noticed some kind of accordion sound. Accordion, is that a popular instrument also in Poland?
Well, yes, kind of popular, mainly maybe in the poverty type of, you know, some street musicians, not that popular in any other areas.
Yeah, I wasn't sure. I actually have an accordion right there. I'm trying
all
to.
All right.
somebody let me borrow it, and I'm trying to learn it for some concert that's coming up.
It's very difficult, I heard, to learn this.
I'll find out. Well, it's like I can play piano. So one side is like a piano.
The
other side is like just a bunch of buttons, a lot of little tiny buttons. So
right, but the toughest point is to coordinate two hands, right? But if you play piano, it's not a problem to you, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I also play the drums, and I have to coordinate all four of my, both my arms and both legs and everything. And I sing while I play the drums. So that's five things I have to coordinate.
Wow, great.
Sometimes. But yeah. So yeah, but anyway, yeah, like you were asking, I teach, my classes are very different. So I've taught, you know, I teach a music class every day, and I've taught everything from, you know, talking about dubstep to rap to folk traditional musics to classical musics to jazz to country music, you know, just anything about music. So anything. And I just like learning about different kinds of music and listening to different kinds of music.
Great.
So yeah. What about you? Do you have a are you a music fan? Do you like listening to music?
Me or Heidi? Heidi, is it you?
You and me now.
Well, I really prefer music. You know Jamiroquai? It's a funky style music, right? I really like him. This is the reason I bought a bass guitar, right? Yeah.
That's right. You were telling me that you thought maybe someday you'd be in a funky.
Yeah, someday. This is.
Hey, it's never too late. You can still do it. You can be, right. I'm starting to learn the accordion, and I'm old.
Right. So I like really, you know, funky music, some 70s, 80s funky music, and sort of trip-hop, like Massive Attack, Tricky, some this kind of stuff.
Yeah. Have you heard, I haven't heard the whole thing, but I've only heard the hit song, I guess, but Daft Punk's new hit single is funky.
Get Lucky?
Yeah, that's a funk song.
Right, right.
What do you think of that song?
Well, I really like it. I wasn't sure till now, but I think that the guitar player is a frontman from this group from 80s, Cheek. I'm not sure if he...
Yeah, he's a famous guitar player, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought he was from... Sly and the Family Stone, but I can't remember. I don't. But yeah, they used a very famous guitar player, and it sounds just like his classic 70s, 80s style. So it's very retro, very retro.
Yeah, yeah. I heard the whole disc and.
Oh, did you? Is the whole thing funk like that? Is it all sound funk like that, or is it different style?
Well, most of it. Most of it, they are. As always, experimenting a little bit, yeah. So, but most of it is rather funky, rather 80s style music.
80s, yeah. I actually taught a class on that album. I think so. I teach classes on everything, but yeah, I taught a class on that Daft Punk album. So.
And do you teach on regular hours or this differ?
Yeah. All the teachers in the Colingo teach on regular hours, so you can schedule your classes based on your interests and the teachers that you want to work with. So we have a big group of teachers. There's like 30 or more teachers, and we all have a different style. We have a different teaching style, and we have some teachers talk about business and finance or sports or whatever, you know. So. You know, anything you want, or movies, or, you know, we have games classes where we play games, working with English, and it could be really fun. So.
And what is it? I saw this 20 question games. This is
you should join it and find out, or you can watch the old classes. You can watch
the
recordings, but that's great. We all have a good time. We're just 20 questions is just a word game where. We work on our listening and speaking and yes or no questions. So the rules of the game is somebody thinks of something, and then everyone has to guess what they're thinking of.
Oh.
And by asking questions that can you've maybe played a version of this before. So, but you can only ask 20 questions, and if you ask 20 questions and you still haven't guessed, then that person wins. The person that is thinking of it wins the game.
It sounds fun.
It's actually really fun. It can be really fun. So you can watch my last class and check it out. But there's some great teachers here, and a lot of interesting interesting classes. Yes. Yeah, I teach a lot of travel classes, food, music, history, stuff like that, arts.
And this 4-grade scale, you know, 100 till 400, this is only for grammar?
This, well, we're working on it. So Colingo is in a transitionary state right now. We used to be a different... the website used to be much different a couple of months ago. And we're slowly changing it into a new, a better experience for the students. And we're working on having this grading, you know, this different class skill levels, where the 100 classes will be more of an advanced beginner or like high beginner.
Mm-hmm.
200 classes, so in general, so grammar, pronunciation, reading, everything will be, you know, slower and easier.
Mm-hmm.
100 level would be like a low intermediate, 300 would be like a high intermediate, and then 400 would be like a low advanced level.
Yeah.
Right now it's not really jiving exactly. It's not really perfect. We're still working on that. So I don't even know what class level this is. What does it say our class is? What number? Because we're not really working with that yet. Let's see here.
Well, third conditional, I think, is the highest.
Oh, we're 400. Okay, this is a 400. Yeah. Okay, good.
Mm.
But, right now, sometimes I teach a 100 class, and the class might be very difficult because most of my classes are basically high advanced, like all of them I teach.
Mm-hmm. Good.
But that might change in the future when we get more strict about these levels. We'll see.
And there will be some placement tests, or will be open?
We're working on that. Well, there should be, actually. We're working on that, where you join Colingo, and then we figure out where you should be, and then we try to... You have a one-on-one teacher, and they tell you which classes they recommend, and which classes that, you know, which things you need to work on, and then they'll recommend certain classes for you or certain teachers or certain topics. But, of course, you can always take the classes that you're interested in. It's no problem. So you can always take any class you want.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have some grammar more? Or?
We could work on third conditional review if you want. Or actually, we're about done with the class, but I think you understand third conditional pretty well.
Yeah, I think so. So, okay, this is my time to go sleep, actually, so.
Yes, it is.
Maybe.
Christoph never joins my music class because it's too late for him. So, even though I taught him, he didn't come.
Okay.
So we'll see you next time. Thanks for coming. It was good
to meet
you. And good night.
Take care. Good night.
Yes, take care.